Saturday night in Toledo, Ohio is like being nowhere at all. All through the day, how the hours rush by. You sit in the park and you watch the grass die. Oh, but after the sunset, the dusk and the twilight, when shadows of night start to fall, they roll back the sidewalks precisely at 10, and people who live there are not seen again. Just two lonely truckers from Kearney, Nebraska, and a salesman from places unknown says unknown. All huddled together in downtown Toledo to spend their big night all alone. You ask how I know of Toledo, Ohio. Well, I spent a week there one day. They've got entertainment to dazzle your eyes. Go visit the bakery and watch the buzz melts.
You know, if you pay property tax on a car, the government should be able to tell you to wear your stinking seatbelt, in my opinion. So what comes to your mind when you think of Phil Vine? Yeah.
I think of him as just a solid, faithful, unsung hero. He is so consistent. He is at church all the time, and he's working with the children's ministry. He helps handle the scheduling for that and everything that goes on with the children. He and his wife Lydia are just rocks. They're just amazing people, and they're just such an encouragement to me and to many others.
Well, okay, so that's all the good stuff.
That's what I'm for.
Listen, we owe the public the truth about Phil Vine.
Okay, what is the truth?
Phil Vine is basically perfect. With Brandon Blackford, it's a treasure trove.
That guy.
I mean, I haven't even known him that long, and I could do 8 episodes on all the negative stuff. Phil Vine, I've known Phil Vine literally since he could barely walk. And I can't think of anything negative to say about the man. He is the type of guy that you do not want to stand behind at the judgment seat of Christ. I mean, I'm glad. I mean, if it's done alphabetically, I'm glad that the B's and the V's are like separated a lot. Where are we going?
I don't know. Turn right. I think we go up Stearns.
What a blessing to have somebody who just faithfully and quietly serves, loving husband to an unbelievable woman. I mean, they are just incredible. Their kids are incredible. I think their daughter was like speaking French when she was 4 months old or something. I mean, I've never in my life, and I've seen some fast learners, I have never seen a learner like that kid. Holy cow.
I remember that one time we filled in the nursery one evening, and she was not very old at all. 2?
Yeah.
3? And she was...
like, could read.
Reading.
Unbelievable. He is now so much a part of the fabric of our history that Phil Vine is sort of an institution. I mean, he kind of represents an entire era of the Toledo Baptist Temple. Mm-hmm. Phil's story of God's grace when you really understand his background and his history.
Goodness gracious.
first times my wife tried to kill me. As soon as we got back from our, honeymoon, we get on a jet ski together.
Okay.
And I get thrown off the jet ski, and my wife is driving the jet ski, and she turns around and heads straight for me and won't move. And she smoked me right in the head drove right over the top of me.
I was circling back to get you, and I went around, and I did not see you for about 20 seconds. And it was... I mean, I don't know, did it push you
it
down?
Wasn't like a, it wasn't a graze. It was a flat out bam smoke.
Has this made it into a sermon illustration yet? Of all the things that you've shared throughout the years.
I know. I mean, listen, everyone has this perception of how our marriage goes, but the truth of the matter is Blondie's got a little spunk in her, and she's a fighter. Blondie's a fighter.
I appreciate that. This is not the dirt on Lydia hour or anything, but yeah, I get it. I get the spunk thing.
If we start naturally going down the dirt on Lydia path, I think we just need to roll with it.
Okay.
I mean, I don't know what's going on behind closed doors. I don't know if the broken plates, tears, threats, I don't know. It appears that you guys have an idyllic relationship. Now, I know that obviously, you know, the Word of God and doctrine and Christ and all of that, and I'm not saying like, yeah. Now let's get to the real stuff.
Okay.
But just beyond what we would accept as what makes a good marriage, do you guys feel that somehow you guys have been able to use that to actually make a better marriage, to actually turn some lemons into lemonade?
We often imagine what it would be like if we had, you know, if we had a more ideal family, you know, life growing up, and one of us walked in with that and the other one walked in with the circumstances that we have, like it would be very hard to even understand.
A lot of the things that I hear Christians use about their past as an excuse for why they're cynical or bitter or not involved or don't trust church or don't get involved in ministry. And I'm not trying to, you know, make you out to be this Teflon amazing saint that you're going to be completely embarrassed about.
Yeah, no.
But it didn't seem to stick to you, and I've never seen you use it, not even as a kid.
Yeah.
As an excuse.
You know, when I was growing up, in very very young in my life, I had he still does. My dad struggled with alcoholism. And I mean, it was very bad. At times there was a lot of physical abuse. There was definitely a lot of psychological abuse in our household. And there are lots of statistics about people who grow up in those situations. Like, and I'm sure that the number of people who actually just decide, you know, my father is my example of God in this world, completely blew up my childhood that way. And, you know, does that destroy Christianity for me? We go into counseling sessions when my parents finally got divorced, and they were like, this is not your fault. And I was just a very logical kid, right? Like, I just always was, especially around that. Like, I just kind of receded into to being very logical about it. And I was like, listen, Mr. Counselor, I get that. Like, you don't have to convince me. Like, I clearly know what happened here, and I know this is not my fault. And, you know, I wasn't as on fire for the Lord immediately thereafter, because, I mean, I was thinking it was like, frankly, I don't remember specifically, but I was somewhere between 8 and 10 years old at that point when my parents divorced. And it was just like, I was just a kid. I'm sure we were trying to figure out survival, right? Like, there were times when, like, yeah, decide to do that with us what you will, but like, there was direct threats of violence against me when I was like 5, 6, 7 years old to hurt my mom. And like, you know, she's just trying to get away from the situation sometimes, go take a walk, and he's like, no, if you take him, I'm going to do X, Y, and Z to him, and it's gonna, like, crazy stuff.
Wow.
And now, you know, Wildwood Baptist Church sort of became my family. I remember multiple times that after all that, that your dad came when I was, because I acted out a ton after that. And I was pushing boundaries and probably, you know, being what my dad was for a while, and just being really nasty to my mom. And I felt, in hindsight, you know, clearly wish I hadn't done that. But, you know, I remember your dad coming and having like the, this is what you need to do now. I'm just seeing this, the consistent service of my church van driver, right? Every week, there to pick us up, supporting us. Throughout our entire lives, we got food baskets. I mean, we did not have much money growing up. I mean, I would say that we were definitely below the poverty line, and we had that abuse situation and the alcoholism, and it was just like, the church was always there, always. Paul DeLand was my sixth grade Sunday school teacher. He's been a Sunday school teacher at the church for,
man,
I don't even know how many years. I don't even know. He's for as long, for probably as long as I've been there and longer. So 34, but somewhere between 30, 40 years, right? And I just got to see how he lived with his family and how he composed himself. And I got to see your dad just be consistent day in and day out with, you know, the message that he preached, and he was not this big emotional guy. He was very logical. I connected with that a little bit more.
Right.
So many different people throughout the church touched us. A mantra for me in my life is like, I need to be who I'm supposed to be in the circumstance that I'm in.
Yeah, three large Dr. Peppers and a large Coke. This company owes me, because I've had two men already. If you're even slightly interested in this product,
sure,
you will be the third. And it is Secrid, S-E-C-R-I-D. Don't get the knockoff, get the real thing.
Okay.
And it is something to behold. Phil, we need you to video this scene. Emily didn't push record either.
Smooth.
Thank you, ma'am. That should be the tagline for purchasing. It needs to be Jesus paid. Jesus paid. All your day. This is kind of your old neck of the woods.
We're heading that way, yeah. Like, you know, fast forward all these years, and you know, I have called my dad up. I was just like, Dad, you know, like, for whatever it's worth, like, listen, I just want to put all this ugliness that was behind us, and just have a real, you know, relationship going forward. You broke me when I was a kid, and I the world would, given what I've been through, the world I think would be completely okay with me saying I'm done, right?
Yeah.
And I don't need to love you, and I don't need to be kind to you and forgive you for what you've done.
What was his response to that?
He called me a bunch. Like, he called me several weekends in a row and just wanted to talk, right? It just, like, instantly shifted to a little bit more normal.
God called Max Vine a father.
Yep.
He pointed you to Jesus Christ.
And just for you to go through that, you know, your situation, then you're able to help somebody else who might be, you
for
know,
sure,
going through the same. And you have a perspective that some of us don't have, a perspective that you can reach somebody, a young kid that has a particularly rough time in the childhood, that you can reach them in a way that others can't.
Yeah.
All things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. That is a conditional promise. It isn't that all things work together for good. It isn't necessarily that everything happens for a reason. That's actually kind of a dumb sentiment. That only becomes true in a realized, growing relationship with Jesus Christ. It's only when you get to the point where you decide, no matter what has gone on in your life, you are going to love God. You are not going to blame God. You are going to be called according to his purpose in life. And then at that moment, when you begin to truly follow Christ in that level of discipleship, all of the bad things in your life, all of a sudden, they start working together for good.
Yeah.
They actually make you stronger. They make you a more effective minister. They make you a better husband. They make you a better dad. You know what God is like because of what he isn't like.
Yeah.
And that becomes your perspective. You look up and, wow, I'm a more effective minister. I'm a more faithful servant. I can do more for the cause of Christ because of what would otherwise have been horrific.
Yeah. Yeah.
He actually made something out of nothing. And only God can do that. Yeah. You know, a lot of people wouldn't know what Mansi's is if we weren't, you know, in this area. But it is one of the finer steakhouses in this section of the country. Oh, yeah. Dad had told me a story about you. And you lived really, really close to here.
Like a mile away from here.
A mile away. And I remember dropping you off and you going into your house, and I pulled out and I made a wrong turn. I pulled out right over there where that Burger King is, because I kind of got lost back there.
Okay.
And I drove by Mansi Steakhouse, and I remember thinking Mansi's was, you know, a veritable stone's throw away from a home. But it dawned on me the kinds of things that I need to awaken to, because of our personalities, people would have assumed that my dad was emotionally detached only because he wasn't outwardly emotional.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think a lot of people have done that with you. They think, well, nothing affects him because, I mean, he's Phil and he's just solid and he is unemotional. Well, no, actually, what I've learned about guys like you and my dad, what they have taught me is it's actually the introvert. It's actually the quiet guy that doesn't need attention all the time and doesn't need to project and emote things in order to let people know what he's going through. Those kinds of people feel deeper and they feel more intensely. I believe that because of growing up with my father. And, you know, no one would ever have guessed about my dad that he saw all of those things and considered those things and was troubled, and I mean deeply troubled, by kids in the church that he knew were having a rough time. I think he saw a young Bill Bartlett in you. The intelligence, the lack of social need, apparently, the analytical manner, the quiet concern, the crazy situations with dads and divorces and growing up by yourself. You're probably more like my dad than anybody that I know. Somehow God used, in about 1998, God used dropping you off at your house and driving by this building to, like, really give me an unattractive glimpse of myself and what I needed to change for ministry. And so to that end, okay, this is what we decided to do, okay?
My face.
I wasn't going to do that. I literally...
We have to talk about something lighthearted.
I know it. I literally told myself... I told myself I wasn't going to do this.
Okay,
I had a pep talk with myself.
Yeah.
That did not work.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So I'm not going to... I'm going to see... There, now, this represents something actual.
Okay.
But it also is a historical reference to us.
Okay.
So I'm not going to say anything more than this.
Okay.
So there's actually two presents involved here.
Okay.
Here's the first one.
Okay. Right?
All right. You have to open it now.
Okay.
Okay.
Foot washer.
Yeah, bam.
Got it.
You remembered.
Yes. yes. I was the winner of the inaugural foot washers award at TBT in the youth department. That was for going to a volleyball tournament.
Yes, we had an award when I was a youth director that we gave out for the servant award. And I would look for an attribute or an act of service that stuck out in my mind of a kid in the youth department who was a servant. And the award was a rag, a dish towel for washing feet, the mm-hmm. foot washers award. Yeah. And that's all that it was. And Phil won the foot washers award. And if we had to have a foot washers award today at Wildwood Baptist Church, you would still be holding the towel. You have not let go of that trophy.
Yeah.
And I wanted to make sure that you understood that what you do for this church is huge. And I do believe that they that are going to be the greatest among you, let them serve. And so you still are the foot washer award winner.
Thank you.
And the other gift is this. As soon as this nonsense is over, Kim and I are going to take you and Lydia out to eat at
Mancy's
Steakhouse.
Thank you.
And you guys can order absolutely anything that you want.
Okay.
Sounds thank
wonderful.
You, Phil.
Thank you guys so much. I appreciate that. Those words are very, very kind. Did you only give that award out one time?
I had that idea.
Yeah.
The last year that I was a youth director.
Oh, that's yeah, okay.
And so it was the
you're still the
it was the yes. first it was the first and only. I mean, you are just holding on to that towel, man.
I know that they that compare themselves among themselves are not wise.
All I can say is pastors who say that they don't have favorites are the biggest liars on the planet. Because the truth is, a pastor has an objective. An objective, if he's worth his salt, he wants to get the work of the Lord done.
Yeah.
I think mantles have to do with history. And Ray Kratz is a part of the history.
Yeah.
Of the Toledo Baptist Temple / Wildwood Baptist Church. And you have been around so long now that you are truly an institution. I don't think there's anything ungodly about giving honor to whom honor is due. Mm-hmm. And I believe what I'm about to tell you, as crazy as it sounds, I believe that the mantle of Ray Kratz at this church has fallen upon you.
Wow. You know, that's crazy that you said that, because when Lydia and I are talking just about, you know, long-term goals for ourselves, because we're not Ed McNeil level goal people, but we're at least trying to have a general direction that we're heading in life, right?
Right.
But
nobody is that goal oriented, by the way.
Two colored markers.
I mean, that's insane levels of goal orientation.
But we say regularly, like, so if she and I, you know, both out working, both trying to do really well at work. But, you know, why? What, you know, we have enough to provide for our family now. We're giving regularly to the church, right? But you know, if we're just going to start, if we're picking up momentum and we're going to have, you know, have some monies accumulated, why? What would be the spiritual point of doing that? We're saying, like, we say all the time, we want to be Ray and Donna Kratz. Mm-hmm. On that
really?
Front, just well, it just like we do. We say that just, you know, missions minded, giving minded, right? This is we're not just amassing this to set the Vine family up in future generations.
I did not know that you and Lydia.
Yeah. Oh yeah,
that's crazy.
Regularly, so
maybe there is something to mantle.
That's a big statement, though. They were an institution. Mm-hmm. They were an inspiration. It's like, I feel like the most loved church member around, even though, you know, every once in a while, it's like, man, Phil Vine just doesn't say anything. No,
does he still go to church?
Well, and you know, you're talking about being institutions. I kind of think, you know, you are the institution of the children's ministry. You know, you go back to that corner, and you and Lydia are there. You know, yeah. I can't kind of see anybody else there, and as kind of a somewhat overlooked ministry at times, as far as, you know, getting help or volunteers, but it's so vital.
Yeah.
And you guys have just taken, I mean, for how many years now?
That's what Lydia and I both want to be. We want to be the people who are there every week, that people see us consistent. We need to show our kids, and we need to prove to ourselves that it's more important that we, even if we have to drag ourselves to church to be there and work and serve the families in our church, that's who we want to be.
We have a rule.
Yes.
Christians in cars getting Cokes, you know the rule. We have to sing ourselves out of the car.
The English KJV, yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the Word of God, English KJV. Bible!
Read your Bible, pray every day, pray every day, pray every day.
Read your Bible, pray every day, and you'll grow, grow, grow. And you'll grow, grow, grow. And you'll grow, grow, grow. Read your Bible, pray every day, and you'll grow, grow, grow.
We're going to turn around. We're going to turn around so we can shrink. There we go. I think we're okay with this other car here. All right. Now, what happens, boys and girls, what happens when we neglect to read our King James Bibles?
Neglect?
We shrink.
Neglect your Bible, forget to pray, forget to pray, forget to pray. Neglect your Bible, forget to pray, and you'll shrink, shrink, shrink. And you'll shrink, shrink, shrink. And you'll shrink, shrink, shrink. Neglect your Bible, forget to pray, and you'll shrink, shrink, shrink.
Oh no, look at us. Look at our sanctification. We've got to grow fast. Here we go.
Read your Bible, pray every day, pray every day, pray every day. Read your Bible, pray every day, and you grow, grow, grow. And you grow, grow, grow. And you grow, grow, grow. Read your Bible, pray every day, and you grow, grow, grow.
Made it.
Awesome. There it is. That's the Christian life in a nutshell, ladies and gentlemen. Don't neglect to read your King James Bible. Ryan Becker. Now there's a Christians and Cars Getting Cokes episode.
Yeah.
Because there's a guy. Let me tell you something about Ryan Becker.
Okay.
There's a guy who has the cerebral, quiet, kind of Bill Bartlett, Phil Vine thing going on as far as his reputation.
Okay.
He can be an absolute card. And people think I'm sarcastic.
Yeah.
People think I'm cynical. Listen, I am Phil Vine in comparison to Ryan Becker.
Okay.
Poor sweet Valerie. How do these girls make the decisions that they make? He would be a good show. Valerie would be a good show because she would give us Ryan stories.
Everybody at the door.